Hello YouTube. This is going to be one of the most awkward video reviews that I ever do because I have an intellectual interest in the subject matter at hand, and I might actually go beyond that, beyond the film and into the subject matter itself when I've come to the end of that. Now, the real life backstory to this is there was a criminal by the name of Edward Morell. He was born in the 1800s, died in the 1900s. So we're talking about 100 years back here. And he served time for his crimes. One of his champions was Jack London. Now, Morell went on to play a part in prison reform. And he brought forward some of his experiences of his incarceration. He spent, I think it was something like 4 or 5 years in solitary, and he also was in San Quentin at a time where they had the practice of using extremely tight straitjackets on inmates. Now, all of these things, as you probably know, have a mental impact on the prisoner, on the person. And Jack London published a book in 1915, about 100 years ago, called The Jacket. And this was based quite solidly on what Morell had told in terms of his experiences. And that came forward to this 2005 film, The Jacket, starring Adrian Brody and Keira Knightley. Now, this is actually rated 15 in the UK. If these sorts of intellectual sides of things appeals to you, then you should be able to get hold of this at a reasonable price, partially because of its age and partially because I'm not sure how it hit the audience. Reading some other reviews on it, I think that some of the reviewers missed the intellectual side of what was going on here. And when they lost their grip on that, they just went along for the ride, because there was quite a bit of emotion packed in there. And we are dealing with a bit of time travel here. The ultimate premise of this is that Brody's character is committed to a mental institution where he is subjected to... he's used as a guinea pig in various experiments. He's believed to have been a murderer, to have murdered a police officer. Therefore, as far as the practitioners are concerned, the gates are open to him. They can do anything. They sort of feel vindicated in doing pretty much the worst to the character. So they bind the character in a straitjacket, pump them full of antipsychotic drugs, and slam them in a mortuary and leave them there. So, complete sensory deprivation, basically. And it explores what this does to the mind. And Brody's character then goes forward in time. Is able to use that to go forward in time. Now, it's a bit messy in some regards. But... it's very interesting. Brody's character does that trip, I think, about 4 times. And some of the reviewers didn't seem to be able to handle the backwards and forwards. It seemed to create a mesh that they couldn't handle, but I loved it. I really did love it. So I'm going to have to get the book at some point, if it's still in print anywhere, or Google haven't snaffled it up as part of their orphaned works, whatever the heck. So I might have some problems getting hold of the book, but the film was absolutely great. I loved it. I loved that kind of intellectual exercise. ironically, when it comes to these subjects, something like this, which is from people outside this sort of thing looking in, has done a much better job than something like this, which is The Pet by TLA Releasing. That's who released that one. And The Pet, as far as I was concerned, was from people who are inside this subject coming out. And to my mind, the pet didn't do anywhere near the kind of job that the jacket has done. The pet, you know, the motives of the characters were a bit of a mess, you know. It seemed that this was written and filmed for people who didn't really care about the storyline. They just sort of liked the action and that was going on. So, I by far prefer the jacket. It handled the intellectual exercise very, very well. And the intellectual side of it, for me, is the effect of things like sensory and motionary deprivation on the mind and what it can do for you and what it does for various individuals at various different times. I find it an incredible subject and have done for many, many years. But it's a subject which still remains outside quite a lot of our understanding, and we're still unlocking the keys to these particular doors. And it's no wonder why things like these engage, because they have been engaging us for quite some time. Here we have the story of O. Pauline Riage. This was actually appeared first under mysterious circumstances at Paris in 1954. That's when it was first published, and it was a book which got much acclaim, and not only did it win awards, but the French police then went and prosecuted the publishers. You know, people are scared, they seem scared of tackling these sorts of subjects, but the human race is so... There are parts within us that we don't know are there, or we don't know how they get there, and we've got no control over them. And that is something that many people don't seem to be even able to acknowledge. And that indeed is one of the common arguments that winds up, that comes in, say, for example, religious circles. If God hates gays, then why are gays born? And people of other persuasions who are born in other ways, for which various religious scriptures are against. And to my experience, no apologist has ever come up with any with any sort of concrete concrete apology for that being the case. And yet more is coming out, which basically supports things, and society is, I believe, starting to wake up to things. I'm not sure if I've read this passage to you before, but Tom Reynolds is a pseudonym of a paramedic, a real-life paramedic who works in London, and he wrote this book, Blood, Sweat and Tea. He's actually written a few more. But among the things is this. This chapter is called Victims. Imagine, if you will, getting sent to a job where a 15-year-old boy is threatening suicide. You turn up at the address and discover that it's a care home. Meeting with one of his carers, she hands you a list of the boy's medications, and it reads like a who's who of psychiatric drugs. You talk to the boy, and he seems calm, collected, and very polite. He explains that he wants to jump out of the window and kill himself, and agrees that he would like to go to hospital. You take him into the pediatric department of a local hospital. As this does not feel like the normal teenager wants to kill themselves, you have a chat with the children's nurse, and you ask them to let you know what happens to the patient. You leave and continue with your shift. The next day, you ask the children's nurse about the patient, and she tells you, "The boy wanted to die because he wants to have sex with and kill small children, and that he knows that it is wrong. I hate paedophiles as much as any other member of society, but in front of me that day, I saw a victim." And, you know, there's other bits and pieces. There was a conversation that happened on... pardon me. That happened on the register. You know, there's people who are trying to fight to censor the internet. And the basic thrust of the argument that people put forward was that children are growing up and have various feelings that they don't understand. And there's nobody there for them to turn to. The only resource they've got is the internet. And if that is closed off, then society risks throwing the baby out with the bathwater, because there will be nothing for these children to be able to use in order to, you know, give themselves a compass on their feelings and work things through. There were a number of anonymous commenters in here. one said, various behaviours are in us as children. We can't turn them off. For me, it was bondage. If I could have had access to information which would have explained those feelings and helped put my mind at rest, then a whole load of emotional and mental turmoil could have been nipped in the bud. As it was, it wasn't. I was swinging between a rock and a hard place, either beating myself up for having these feelings I couldn't control, or else getting myself into some stupefyingly dangerous self-bondage positions. I could have died. Whoever has their finger on the filth button needs to be aware of these things. If the schools aren't teaching it, or have open doors where children can talk through in confident these kind of emotionals that are inside them, then fair enough. But the internet has opened a life-saving resource in some aspects, and the baby just might go out with the bathwater. That's where I got that phrase from. Next time someone says, won't someone please think of the children, I'll give them a black eye and a loud lecture on what effect bigoted, unrealistic expectations actually has on our children. 35 people voted that up and one voted it down. Another anonymous commenter said, AC, I feel your pain. I lost a very good friend as he did not know how to deal with issue he had as a young teen who was transgendered. He ended up overdosing when he was 16. I was aware of his issue and tried to help him, but he came from a very religious home and could not talk to the people who he needed to talk to, his parents, or access information online. It was a very sad day when he killed himself. Sadly, mortality is defined by old values. When my friend killed himself, he left a note that I was sadly one of the few to read, once it would have been beneficial to many people to read. What he said, without quoting verbatim, out of respect and out of his parents' wishes for anonymity, and he wrote, I am now dead. I am not a person, but a persons. I am both K and K. I cannot live with sin, and I can no longer live a lie, so I am forced to die at my choosing. I, as I have said, attempted to help him with the issues he had, so did a select few others he trusted, but his lack of information and lack of support from people outside his own age and wisdom ended up with his death. And I know this might sound like I am playing undue homage to the dead. He would have changed the world, as he was a brilliant person. He could apply himself to any field in school and was the top of the class. Oddly, not in RE or French, but he excelled in Spanish. The last I will say of him, on the reg, is this. I miss him dearly as a friend, and I still, at the summer barbecue, cook a burger for him. Not out of respect, but true sorrow that he cannot be there with me to munch down in it and share a beer. And I hope one day his parents can and will talk about what happened and help others. I miss you, my friend, and still hold you close to my heart. Somebody else. The problem is, when people think of the children, they don't actually think of the children. They just think about how they can avoid awkward conversations with them. And then bad shit like this happens. ACs, I have a lot of LGBT friends I speak to online in a very close community. And I think I can say that if it hadn't been for that community and the access they have to it, a lot of them would have followed a similar path. When people say think of the children, you are right by saying they want to avoid difficult conversations with them. Part of being a parent is the difficult moments, having hard conversations with your child and helping them come to terms with how the world works and the child's place in that world. If you avoid it, your child can make the wrong choice, not for you, for them, and possibly end up like my friend, who in the end felt so isolated he chose to kill himself. I was lucky as a teen and my parents were open. If I needed to talk to them, I could, and they helped me become who I am today. Sure, they might have felt uncomfortable about talking some issues, sex, drinking, etc., but they did, and I am now an adult who is comfortable with himself and others, who is happy and productive. You can't give your children a better start in life than being there for them and talking with them when they need to. And this last page, and then I'm not far off bringing this to a close, I think. There are a few other things, but I think I'll give them a miss. This was, I'm not sure whether this one was an anonymous commenter as well. I think it was. I feel that. I too developed an unusual fetish as a young child, due to being a late developer in the bathroom department. It was something I could never discuss with anyone. I knew it was not what was considered normal. The shame and humiliation of carrying guilty secret around of years. You hide it, but the monster that sleeps at the back of your mind is always there and never goes away. There was no real interest as such until I got to around the age of 19. I spent my teenage years trying to repress my interests in wearing certain garments. I got on with my life, got married and settled down. One day my wife caught me looking at information about my particular proclivity, and years of emotional turmoil were unleashed in a few hours. I was lucky that she knew I was a good person, and that this was just an unusual side to my character. With the aid of information available online from those who practiced it to those who studied it, I was able to show her exactly what the interest was, how it started, and how I felt the same as thousands of other people. It's now something very special we share together. I don't have much need to go online these days about it. It's not about pornography, it's about sexuality. The moral guardians that rule over us think that unless you have sex once a week in the missionary position, then you're a pervert. Well, I have to break it to you, but the mind is a seriously complex bit of kit, and I'm afraid some of us cannot simply stare at a naked person and instantly get turned on. Some of us need a different fuel mix for our engines to fire them up. My daughter is coming up to age 10, so we've had to sit her down and explain the facts of life. The very fact that my wife and I share an unusual interest allows us to be very open with our daughter about sexuality and puberty. We didn't discuss anything outside the accepted norms, but we did say that sex is fun, nothing to be ashamed of, but it should ideally be performed with someone you respect. We briefly explained that people of the same sex can enjoy a loving relationship. People like dressing up and acting out little plays while having sex to make it more interesting. Left it at that. More than anything, we wanted to make sure that she felt comfortable talking about sex and relationships as she heads towards becoming an adult. If she needs to discuss anything, then she can be open about it, whether that's us, a doctor, or any trusted authority figure. Not many people feel comfortable with their sexuality, especially if they think they have what could be seen as an unusual interest. Most people would prefer to find out on their own how different they think they are before they decide to follow a particular path through life. UK government simply sees sex equals porn equals filth equals corrupt society. It's not until you've spent years hiding feelings you know don't seem right that you fully understand the need for open information and understanding. The last thing you need is to be made to feel like a freak about something you can't change and never asked to be given in the first place. If I can, link number 2 will be to the article, and then you'll want to go through to the comments and read them. There were a few other things that raised, and that is the fuel mix of what turns us on. Like, we know the usual the usual culprits, leather, rubber, fur. But, you know, people can be turned on by the most strange things. I'm going to try and find it. because I believe I've seen this before. Right, I'm not immediately finding the article, but if I can, there is a fetish. You know, people have all sorts of fetishes to turn them on. I've met people who have fetishes in for earrings, sneakers, and there are some who have fetishes for balloons, and believe it or not, there are people who have fetishes about fencing. Yep, they can see a nice picket fence, and all of a sudden their heart starts beating that a little bit faster. And nobody really knows why. Nobody knows why they've got these fetishes, and nobody knows how to turn them off, is the most important thing. Some of these things are born with us. We're born with them, and there's nothing that we can do. Having said that, that doesn't make people exempt for responsibility for their actions. People who have various leanings, you know, if they perform some sort of an action based on those leanings, then they are responsible for what they do. There's no denying that. But we need more understanding. We can't just shut things off. I mean, this is rated 15 in the UK. Now, you imagine a 15-year-old with not much experience getting hold of this. And kids are pretty intelligent. And engaging with the intellectual side of what's going on in this, and then trying to go to their parents and asking some questions. That's going to get pretty messy pretty fast. And that poor kid is going to have unanswered questions, and who knows what's going to that's going to do to them. And yeah, so that's that part. How do I view fetishes? I actually view fetishes as being the reverse of phobias. A phobia is an irrational response. You know, I have a phobia against spiders. Other people have phobias against snakes. Those are the common ones. The not so common ones. Did you know that there's actually someone with a phobia against tomatoes? I'll try and look that one up. Phobia tomato. Whoops. Phobia tomatoes. Yep. What do you call a phobia of tomatoes? And it's not tomatophobia. Not tomatophobia. It's not a common one. However, almost all names for phobias follow the tradition of Greek. Yeah. There are phobias of tomatoes, believe it or not. And some people who have that phobia, whenever they get within a certain distance of a tomato, their nose itches. Fetishes, as far as I'm concerned, are the opposite of phobias. They are, again, irrational. People who have them don't know why they have them, but it fires their soul. It starts their heart beating a little bit faster. It pushes their buttons, but they just don't know why. Again, it is irrational. So there we have it. A good film. The Jacket is a good film. The premise for it started over 100 years ago, or roughly 100 years ago, so it's not new. This kind of thing has been hanging around in society for a while. It was a very intellectual exercise for me. Explored a subject which I very much have been following for a good portion of my life, and I think that, you know, one of the things that strikes me as odd is that things like that can, our laws are all to hell, you know? As part of some of the laws in the UK was the Obscene Publications Act. That was put in the hands of the Crown Prosecution Service. Now, part of the things, for example, where the Crown Prosecution Service can bring a charge is bondage, especially where gags are used. Now, you look at something like Pulp Fiction, which has scenes which definitely tick that box, but yet they're published. So, it's, you know, our lawmakers seem to know that society has two sides to it. And these laws remain on our books, but what is the point of laws which are so unevenly applied? And that's a subject which the Crown, that's a question which the Crown Prosecution Service has failed to answer for me. They've completely failed to answer that question. But it concerns me that we have a lot of media in our society which tackles these sorts of things, or at least puts a spark there. There are other children who are wandering around with a spark that's put inside them by Mother Nature. But yet, when they start asking questions, our society is not only unable to answer them, but we seem to be cutting off all the avenues that would give those children some answers to the questions, to those very awkward questions, those questions of the things that are inside them that they don't understand, that will be gnawing at them all the way into their adulthood, until they are finally able to research this stuff for themselves. Oh, what a tangled web we weave. But yeah, very interesting film. Love the intellectual subject matter. Yeah. More please. Whoever made this. It was a Warner independent picture, but I can't tell from this tiny print as to who the heck directed it. Anyway, there is a website, thejacketmovie.co.uk. .co.uk? I wonder if it's even available in the US. Oh well. So, there you are. I'm going to have to get the book now. Sorry, I'm going to have to get the book. And this film would have flown straight under my radar if it wasn't for someone who pointed it out to me. Thank you very much. You know who you are, but because of the subject matter, I'm not going to mention any names. So, I hope that this has been of interest to you. I know it's been a bit of a long one because it's been a bit of an awkward one, and it, you know, it's got meaning for me. I'm interested in that subject matter. If you've got any questions, ask away. There's some things which I won't be able to answer. Not because I'm not able to answer them, but because I might drop a few other people in it. But there you go. So, yeah. Society. Humans. People. How we deceive ourselves. Take care, YouTube. I'll catch you in the next video. Bye.